Professor Gavoor, I want to talk about quality management and basically provide an introduction to this subject in two parts. The topics we'll cover are answering what seems like a simple question, what is quality, but it's really not. We want to talk about the types of quality and what's total quality or total quality management, quality and design, quality gurus, some of the luminaries of this field, and process improvement and problem solve. So basically, how do you define quality? Well, what is quality? One of the ways is, you know, I know it when I see it. Another one is, I love this definition from Ed Fogarty, who was the president of Colgate, Palmolive United States, U.S., around 1991. He said, quality is when a mother pushing a grocery cart stops, selects your product, and takes money out of her pocket to buy it. And then if she keeps buying it, that really defines quality. Another way of looking at it is QCD, quality, cost, and delivery. Still no help, but this doesn't help define quality. And if you Google QCD, quality, cost, and delivery, you can read a lot of things about that. So here's a textbook definition. Quality has been defined in a number of ways. When viewed from a consumer's perspective, it means meeting or exceeding customer expectations. That's a pretty good definition. If you go to the dictionary, it's the standard of something as measured against other things of similar kind, the degree of excellence of something, an improvement in product quality, synonyms are standards, grade, class, caliber, condition, character, nature, form, rank, value, which will come up again, level, and more. It's also a distinctive attribute or characteristic possessed by someone or something. He shows strong leadership qualities. So it's a feature, a trait, an attribute, a characteristic, a point, an aspect, a facet, a side, a property. These are all kinds of definitions of what quality is. The American Society for Quality, the professional association for quality professionals in the United States, says it's a subjective term for which each person or sector has its own definition. In technical usage, quality can have two meanings. The characteristics of a product or service that bear on its ability to satisfy stated or implied needs. That supply implied needs is kind of interesting. A product or service free of deficiencies, according to Joseph Duran, a guru that we'll be talking about a little bit later, quality means fitness for use. According to Philip Crosby, I don't even consider him a guru, but okay, it means conformance to requirements. So you can see it's not an easy thing to define. I think the customer perspective is really important, and customers know it when they see it. And that visual image of people buying, taking your product off the shelf and taking money out of their wallet to pay for it over and over again is another good image to have when you're thinking about quality. But quality is not new. It's been defined since Aristotle. It's not an act, it's a habit. I'm not sure if Aristotle said it, but it sounds good. Quality is never an accident. It's always the result of intelligent effort. I guess once in a while it could be an accident, but consistently, quality is the result of intelligent effort. And this collage here talks about all the different aspects that seem to be involved in this. You have guarantees, you have specifications, standards, reliability, durability, management, promise, products, choice, everything is in here. Probably value should be in there too, right there. And I don't know why I put this in here. Don't believe everything you read on the internet just because there's a picture with it, with a quote next to it. You know, don't fall for false quality, I guess. But I just love this little image. All right, what are the types of quality and what is total quality? Well, there's product quality, there's service quality, and there's organizational quality. Together, I guess we would call that total quality. And when we talk about TQM or total quality management, it's a management approach to long-term customer satisfaction. It's based on the participation of all members in an organization in improving products or improving processes, products, services, and the culture they work in. That's from Quality Progress Management, or Quality Progress Magazine, from all the way back in 1992. Total quality management was pretty hot back then. From the General Accounting Office of the U.S. that put a pamphlet together called Management Practices, U.S. Companies Improve Performance Through Quality Efforts. The principles of total quality that they talk about are customer-focused quality, continuous improvement, employee participation, actions based on facts, data, and analysis as opposed to just off the top of your head, and strong quality leadership. All of these are important. They're equally important. I've often on exams asked students to pick which one they think is most important. It makes for interesting reading. Mostly customer-focused quality and strong quality leadership tend to lead in those kinds of polls. If we talk about quality dimensions or perspectives, and I can't spell perspectives here. Now I can. There was an interesting article by Anna Marr, and there's a link for it if you want to look at it. It's called, and really what we look at here is she's talking about these dimensions or perspectives. Is it fit for the purpose? Is a product or service fit for the purpose it was intended? Does it conform to requirements? We'll talk a little bit more about that later. Quality is certainly a cost. Every time you inspect something, every time you have to rework something, every time you have to scrap something for bad quality, there's a cost involved. Quality is a price. Can you charge more for a high quality item? Yes. If it costs you less to produce a high quality item than someone else's poor quality item, you can charge less than they charge for it and provide a better product. This is exactly what the Japanese did to the U.S. auto manufacturers in the 1970s. Quality is a standard. And we'll talk about standards and requirements a little bit. Quality is value for performance. What is value? The appreciation you get from paying for something. I mean, one of the examples I give is you can't compare Ruth's Chris Steakhouse to McDonald's, but you can compare McDonald's and Burger King or Taco Bell and then talk about the value you get for money, and you can compare Ruth's Chris Steakhouse to any number of other steakhouses, Morton's, for example. Quality is also an experience. How does it make you feel? It's a perception. More on this was from David Garvin from a 1987 Harvard Business Review article and a book that he wrote about the dimensions of quality. And it's not unlike what Anna Marr had written. Performance. How does a product or service, and let's just talk products right now. How does a product perform? Does it do what you expect it to do? Does it do more than you expect it to do? What are the features? Well, I'm used to getting, let's again think automobiles, I'm used to expecting these features on an automobile. Ooh, this new one has all these other cool features. And they were the first ones out in the block with it. So maybe I like the features. Reliability, does it last a long time? Conformance, and conformance is to certain standards. Durability, can it take a beating? serviceability. If something goes wrong with it, can it be fixed easily and quickly? Are the aesthetics pleasing? How does it look? How does it feel? And then this idea of perceived quality, which is important. How do I feel about the product? What is my perception about this? So quality is an experience, leads to this perceived quality. I've added something else here that we have to talk about. Human health and safety. This is the idea of must be quality. It refers to basically the quality attributes or specifications that are only noticed by the user or consumer when they're missing. Must be quality. You don't think about a light switch ever, except when you flip the light switch and it doesn't work. You might actually first thought might be, it's the light bulb is out. But then you change the light bulb and it still doesn't work, and the switch is broke. Switches never break. I remember when I was younger, my father used to change them in our house all the time. In a year, we'd probably change a light switch or two. They were less reliable than they are now. Now, I don't even think about light switches. They work all the time. I've never changed one unless I want to make it a dimmer. But when it comes to this must be quality, I only notice it when it fails. So the same is for human health and safety. We expect our food, our pharmaceuticals, and other products to be safe. And when they're not, we take notice of it and think very badly of that. So it's this idea of must be quality. On the flip side, there was a guy named Noriaki Kano, a Japanese quality thinker in the 80s and 90s. And he also talked about exciting quality on the other end of it. Those are the things that if you talk about what Anna Marr talked about, or what David Garvin has talked about, is features and its perceived quality and aesthetics. If I can provide something that excites the customer and gives them something that they didn't expect, but the moment they saw it, know that they wanted it, and you're the first one on the block to do that, you're the innovator. You're the leader. You're creating new, exciting products that people love. People will flock to your product because of that. And if it has all these other things, reliability, durability, etc., you've got a winner. So oftentimes, when we talk about this must-be quality, especially when we're talking about human health and safety, food safety, pharmaceutical safety, and other product safety features, they're often covered by government standards and regulations. So it falls under sometimes a category called regulatory, which means that branch of quality that makes sure that you adhere to all government standards and regulations. I think Anna Marr probably talked about it as quality as a standard, and David Garvin's when he talked about conformance. So let's talk about quality in design. Because you can't build quality if you don't design it. You can't build in quality. You're limited by however much the design is conceived and structured and engineered and created in a quality manner. You know, if we're talking about design as a new product or service, is it evolutionary? Is it next generation? Or is it a disruptive product? When we talk about evolutionary products, we're talking about line extensions. We're talking about, okay, we have Oreos. We have Oreos with double stuff. We have Oreos with, I think even for a while they were selling inside out Oreos where the cream was on sandwiched the wafer in between them. So it was like inside out basically. Line extensions for Apple phones are famous for this. And sometimes they get, after about iPhone 5, they kind of all got blurred together until maybe the iPhone 11 now. So the iPhone 5 to the 5S to the 5C, however they do it, the SE they have now, which is built on the iPhone 5 platform. Those are all line extensions. They're evolutionary products. You know, you have a Honda Civic 2019, and you come out with a 2020 Honda Civic, and it's only got small tweaks to it. If you talk about next generation products, maybe you're talking about something new, something different, something kind of starts adding excitement to things. And this is going from a flip phone that you could text and, you know, you had to use the three-letter texting system, which I don't know how many people still recall that. And then the innovation of the smartphone. And what that did, was that disruptive or was it a line, you know, kind of a next generation vestige of that? And lastly, you have disruptive products. It's something entirely new, making the old product obsolete. It was the iPod and iTunes, which is now, I mean, that was like all the rage in the early 2000s, and now I think iTunes is barely a shadow of itself. Our streaming service has taken over. Digital photography killed the film business and killed the film camera business and created an entirely new way. I mean, it put Kodak, the largest manufacturer of film in the world, out of business because they could not adapt. So when we start thinking about design, and we just talked about three kinds of design. If you're, first of all, starting out on what you want to design, are we designing an evolutionary product, a next generation product, or a disruptive product? It's easier to design an evolutionary product. That's pretty easy. It's easy to design some, it's a little bit harder, but still kind of easy to design a next generation. This is dependent on maybe some new technology or some new methodologies. But to design a disruptive product, it's hard to go into a design project and decide that you want to make a disruptive product if the technology is not leading you there, or you can't do it. One of the geniuses of Steve Jobs in doing this kind of disruptive work is he could see the technology that was out there and a way to put it together. I mean, there's an old story that Xerox's Palo Alto Research Institute had invented the mouse. They had all the features that made the Mac such a popular PC and laptop, but they never were able to put it all together and market it. He was able to do things like that. He's the one that could say, let's put a hard drive, if we can make it small enough, inside a handheld device so that we could eliminate CD players and cassette players and you could just carry 2,000 songs with you at one time. And then let's use iTunes as a way to sell you more songs at a very standard price for every song. He was the one that took the phone and reinvented it using the same principle by putting advanced storage in it, making the interface so simple, and using a big screen instead of a small screen, and inventing the smartphone. So you've got to be able to see those things. So when we talk about advanced quality planning, you know, you have to have some idea. When you're going into a new product development, you have some key product attributes that you want to have. And these often are from marketing and sales. They will say, hey, let's invent, let's launch a new chocolate. And maybe it's going to be individually wrapped chocolate. And, you know, we want it to be, you know, let's use customer words to describe these attributes. And the attributes may be really silky smooth and leaves a chocolate aftertaste or something like that. I'm not a confectionery food scientist by any means. But you want to take those like glowy consumer kinds of terms and translate those key attributes into product characteristics or specifications. You can't make silky smooth in a factory, but you could buy certain grades of chocolate and specify those grades that you want, certain grades of confectionery sugar. You could buy machines that, when it mixes all the raw ingredients for the chocolate that you're going to make, really make sure that it grinds it and into a very fine paste or cream or sludge, which is not a good word to use for chocolate. But the finer you can grind all the things, and the kind of ingredients you use maybe have a low melting point, that will give you that silky smooth flavor and feel in the mouth when you eat the chocolate. So you've got to translate what you're trying to achieve for the customer into key product characteristics. This is called advanced quality planning. Then the next question you ask is, okay, you've defined these key product characteristics, specifications, and a specification is maybe we want to, you know, it's usually a range. It could be a length, it could be a weight, it could be a chemical composition of something. And you don't just say, I want it to be at this number. I don't want, if I have a length, I want it to be 1 inch long. No, you say, I want it to be 1 inch long plus or minus 3/1000ths of an inch. Because there's always going to be variation. That's one of the rules that you have to learn in quality. Everything that you manufacture, everything that you do varies. Variation is usually the enemy that you're trying to tame in quality management. And by tame it, we basically mean reduce it so you can do things more consistently. So when you look at these ranges in which you want to control your product, it could be a range for the recipe, it could be a range for how you heat it up and cook it, it could be a range in the weight, it could be whatever you think about. So, once you have these design specs, these key product characteristics specified for your design, you have to ask the question, can we make this with our current equipment? Or does it require new equipment? I recall an example when I was working in seatbelts, and a new seatbelt design had plastic parts in it that basically tripped the switch or tripped a mechanical mechanism that locks up the seat belt. It had a ball bearing in it. If the ball bearing, if your car deaccelerated so fast, the ball bearing would shift its position. You know, as your car is stopping, the ball bearing would go forward a little bit. It would trip a plastic switch, which would then engage the metal parts to lock your seatbelt and keep you from sustaining injuries by hitting the dashboard or steering wheel. Well, the plastic parts in this retractor, which is what the part was called, had to be at really precise kinds of specifications in terms of length and width and all of these things. And most of the equipment people had couldn't manufacture it. So if you're in that situation, now you have to ask the question, can we afford the new equipment, or do we have to relax our design and therefore perhaps relax the quality standard at which we want the new product to be? So here's the best situation. If you can do it with current equipment, that's fantastic. So we have, can you make it with current equipment, or do you need new equipment? And then it's yes, no. Okay, well, we invest. You can't do it with current equipment, but with new equipment, you can. That's good. But now it becomes a question. Do we want to invest to bring this product to market? or do we want to relax our standard and make it, maybe instead of making it an evolutionary product, making it a line extension? What if you can't make it with the current equipment and you can't make it with new equipment? Well, you have two choices. You can go back to the drawing board and redesign it for equipment that's currently available. And by equipment, I'm talking about machines on the factory floor, of course. Or you go back to the drawing board and design the equipment that can do it. One of the advantages that Gillette had in the razor business for many years was they kind of designed and they didn't build their own equipment, but they had it built according to their designs. And other companies could not copy them. So their blades were more precise, they were sharper, they were perfectly set geometrically into the, you know, the replacement cartridges. And when they started coming up with the dual blade, and then three, I think they're up to four or five now, which is kind of crazy. They were able to do that in a way that no one else could. Well, over time, everybody else kind of caught up with them. And they have to look at maybe they've lost that innovative edge because the rest of the world has caught up with them. And I'm not sure what more we can do with razor blades, you know, handheld razor. So, also, when you have these key product characteristics, those things that define your product according to the marketing and sales idea of what, you know, consumer research they've done and what consumers want, how do you manage these characteristics? How do you want to control the characteristics? How do you want to, what do you want to do? What's your plan? If it's the characteristics are not met, in other words, you've created some defects. And a defect is basically a product in which one or more key product characteristics are out of the specification area. This is a manufacturing view of this, of course. A defect to a consumer is if the thing breaks or causes harm, or doesn't function as expected. And the reason that you have these specifications is you know that if you've designed it properly, the specifications set a standard at which if you build all the parts within those standards, theoretically the product should be kind of in a perfect condition for functionality. If it's outside of that, those specifications, either it's too long, it's too short, it weighs too much, it doesn't weigh enough, you didn't use the right material, you used a different material, you run the risk of, you've created defects, and you run the risk of consumers noticing it, especially if the product fails in any way, breaks, or does not deliver to the expectations under which they bought it. So what's the cost of mitigation if caught in production? What's the cost if it fails? If it costs in production, you can just rework it or scrap it. If it's caught, if it fails in the field, what's the severity of the defect? What's the probability of occurrence? And oftentimes we'll look at something called a failure mode and effects analysis, which even though it's FMEA, it's pronounced FEMA. I think because just people dyslexically read it, or it's easier to say FEMA than FMEA. Oftentimes, if you're talking about seatbelts or safety-related items, you have to do one of these. This started in the airline industry, in which you go through every possible defect, and you have a phone book of defects, and what's the severity of the defect, what's the probability of occurrence, and you basically classify them as high, medium, and low. And if you have a high severity of the defect and you have a high probability of occurrence, and it's an airplane, that's something that could down the airplane. So you want to make sure that you address that in the design portion. Design quality. Attributes define design quality. Can we compare McDonald's and Morton Steakhouse or Ruth Chris? Can we compare Ford and Ferrari? I would say no, they're very different. They have different classes of customers. They're different price points. They're different. But can I compare the Corolla, the Toyota Corolla, to the Civic, to the Chevy Cruze? Can I compare McDonald's to Burger King to KFC to Taco Bell? Quality and customer expectations are defined differently when I can't compare them. But quality and customer expectations are kind of sort of the same in this next category where I can compare them. Let's even go back to microeconomics. They define things as inferior goods, normal goods, or luxury goods. So inferior good doesn't mean it's necessarily it's a horrible product. It's just the kind of products that, as one's income increases, it falls in demand. The demand for this product decreases. It has a negative income elasticity of demand. An example of an inferior good is Tesco Value Bread. Or if you think of Colgate Palmolive toothpaste, it's Ultra Bright, which is their value brand, which means their cheaper brand versus Colgate Total. When your income rises, you buy less Tesco Value Bread and more high quality organic bread. A normal good is probably the bulk of the goods that people purchase, especially if we're talking about consumer products. This means an increase in income causes an increase in demand. It has a positive income elasticity of demand. And a normal good can be income elastic or income inelastic. A luxury good means an increase in income causes a bigger percent increase in demand. It means that the income elasticity of demand is greater than one all the time. For example, high-definition TVs would be luxury, could be a luxury item. And I don't know how long ago this was because everybody kind of, I think any TV you buy now is almost high-definition by standard, and they're as low, as cheap as $300. But when income rises, people spend a higher percent of their income on a luxury good. Note that a luxury good is also a normal good, but a normal good is not necessarily a luxury good. Products in the same class are compared by styles, features, and innovation. The desirability and this idea of value again, which is satisfaction for the price paid. Does the product disappoint customers? Does it meet customer expectations? Or does it exceed customer expectations? Does customer satisfaction increase with time of ownership? I'll never forget when I first went, the only time I went to Japan, and we were visiting, I was working in the auto industry in the United States for Ford Motor Company at the time, and then Rockwell International, which produced auto parts. And one of the things that people in the Toyota, we went to Nagoya, and we talked to people in the both Toyota and suppliers to Toyota, which are all part of the same, what the Japanese call a kodetsu, or family of companies, which are loosely interconnected. And they always thought that for a vehicle, they wanted their vehicles, they wanted people's appreciation for their cars to increase with each year of ownership. That was a shocking, different way. I thought it was impossible to even think that way when it came to automobiles. You buy a $40,000 automobile and you drive it off the lot. Just by signing your name to it and driving it off the lot, it goes down to, it becomes a $35,000 car immediately. I mean, prices depreciate. A 5-year-old car, a 10-year-old car, a 15-year-old car, if you're buying it with 100,000 miles on it or 150,000 miles on it, you can buy them for $2,000-$3,000. And things wear out. Water heaters go, or water pumps go, brakes, tires. Well, they're wear items, so they go all the time. The engine doesn't work as well. There's noises that you didn't hear in a brand new car. There's it's a rattle trap. It's just the car deteriorates over time. Except, I did buy a Toyota after I left the U.S. industry, moved to Connecticut, and I bought a Toyota 4Runner. Well, first, I wanted to buy a 4Runner, and it was too expensive. It was $5,000 more than a Chevy Blazer, and a Chevy Blazer, I think it was 1996, 7, 8, had zero interest. I had to buy it because I didn't have the money to buy the car I really wanted, which was the 4Runner. At 100,000 miles, that car was done. Well, probably because for the last 30,000 miles, my college-age son drove it and drove it like a madman. But still, it did last. So then I went to buy another car. I gave him, when I first gave him that first Blazer, I went to buy another one. I said, well, this time I'll buy my 4Runner. Well, again, Chevy had a great deal, and they were $5,000 less. And I debated, and voted with my pocketbook instead of my heart or my brain or whatever, and bought another Blazer. Same problem. It was the same vintage Blazer. It only lasted 100,000 miles, and it required so many repairs, and it was the resale value was so low on it. We had to get rid of it. But somewhere along the line, my daughter went to college. So I gave my son the first Blazer, and he, like I said, drove it into the ground, but then he went to law school in Washington, D.C., didn't need a car. Thank God. So the next Blazer I had, I gave to my daughter when she went to college. And I finally bought, in 2002, a Toyota 4Runner, the one in this picture. I will tell you, I sold it in 2018. It had 200,000 miles on it. I actually broke my heart a little bit to sell it and bought it, but I bought a new 4Runner, which I love very much. But this car did exactly what the Toyota people wanted to do. My appreciation for it grew over time. This picture is probably in 2016. This is a 2002 car. And this is a photo from probably 2016, 2017. It was in great shape. It ran well. It made some funny noises. But I could have probably driven it for another 100,000 miles. I would pull up the people at red lights that had the same car. We'd lower our windows. How many miles you got on yours? How many miles you got on yours? It was probably one of the best cars, I would say, made in the past 20, 30 years. But anyway, that's a long-winded way of saying, does customer satisfaction increase with time of ownership? Sure, things wore out, but my appreciation for the durability and reliability of this vehicle increased. I was a little heartbroken to actually turn it in. I got over that. Now, here's another rule that AT&T used. It's called the 1-10-100 rule for product changes. And basically, it starts with this. If you have a product that's in design and you've drawn a picture of part of it and you decide, oh my God, there's a mistake here. Let me fix that. Well, it costs you $1 to move the line or change the line or change the specification, whatever the case may be, right? Maybe $10, depending on how far along in the design process you are. But if you catch the error once you get into prototype, that same error that you could have fixed for a dollar might not be $100 or might not, now be $1,000. You've committed prototypes, and if you, oh, geez, we made a mistake, I've got to fix that design. I've got to go back and redesign it. I've got to make some more prototypes that I want to test it before I actually launch the product. Boom. You've wasted thousands of dollars. If you don't catch the error, the design error, until you get the product startup, it could be tens of thousands of dollars to make the fix. And if you wait till it gets into the field, it could be hundreds of thousands of dollars to make the fix. And if it's a product like an automobile where there's warranties, it could cost you millions of dollars. And if it's a safety-related thing that you didn't catch that you could have caught here, you could have a recall, which is millions upon millions of dollars. So the more proactive you could be and solve things up front, the cheaper it is to catch your error and fix it. So you want to do it right the first time, which is a mantra that people use. So I'm going to end here, and we'll continue with part two so that you don't have to watch one huge long video on this. Thank you very much.